Remember Dr. Sleep, Gilles Lefebvre, from the Réal Chartrand episode? Guess where he ended up practicing when he returned from Morocco? The Douglas Psychiatric Institute for the Insane. This is who killed Teresa.
Oh, where are you now? Pussy willow that smiled on this leaf. When I was alone, you promised a stone from your heart. My head kissed the ground.
I'm speaking of the doctor who treated the patient on leave from the Pinel Institute, who over the course of a Thanksgiving weekend in 1971 shot and killed Constable Gabriel Labelle in the village of Saint-Thérèse, Quebec, north of Montreal. This is all detailed in an earlier post podcast, More of a Psychopath Than His Patient. Recall that Dr. Lefebvre was initially Chartrand's attending psychiatrist at the Pinel Institute, but the doctor developed an inappropriate relationship with his patient, plying him with money and gifts and an expensive car, a Pontiac GTO. Dr. Lefebvre was eventually fired from the Pinel Institute, and his license was revoked for his actions in the Chartrand affair. He went into exile, spending 7 years in Morocco, but when he came back, he was almost immediately hired by Montreal's English psychiatric hospital, the Douglas Institute. More on Lefebvre later. We've done an episode on the Philippe Pinel Institute for the Criminally Insane. Today's story is about the Douglas.
With Eskimo chain, I tattooed my brain all the way. Won't you miss me? Wouldn't you miss me at all?
It has many names: the Douglas Hospital, the Douglas Mental Health University Institute, the Douglas Research Center. Locals refer to it just as the Douglas or Dougie. It was originally called the Protestant Hospital for the Insane to distinguish it from the Saint-Jean-de-Dieu Asylum, the Catholic hospital offering similar services to French patients. Like most things in Montreal that separate the French and the English, Saint-Jean-de-Dieu was located in the east end of the island near Hochelaga-Maisonneuve. When it burned down in 1890, Saint-Jean-de-Dieu was reborn as the Hospital Louis H. Lafontaine, or the Louis H. For a time, one of the largest psychiatric facilities in Quebec. The Protestant Hospital, which became the Douglas, is located in the West End region of Verdun, across the Lachine Canal from Parc Angrignon. The Douglas Institute is now affiliated with Montreal's largest and oldest academic facility, McGill University. The Pinel Psychiatric Institute, located in the East End to the north, shares an association with the largest French academic institution, the University of Montreal. It's not entirely irrelevant to mention that McGill was also the home of the Allen Memorial Institute, also known by locals as the Allen, a psychiatric facility on the McGill campus that in the 1950s and 60s was heavily involved in the CIA's Project MKUltra, a program to help the United States to attempt to weaponize mind control. We could spend an entire episode on MKUltra. For now, let's just say that the program involved the experimentation on human subjects with paralytic drugs like LSD and subjecting patients to prolonged drug-induced comas. There's a book on the Montreal experiments called In the Sleep Room by Anne Collins, who just happens to be one of my editors at Penguin Random House. But this is not a story about MKUltra. And if you're looking for that tale, I've heard that the podcast called Endless Thread did 5 parts on MKUltra called Madness. Any Montreal message board will provide you with all kinds of horror stories about misfortunes of somebody's granddad locked in a dog cage, or the sexual and drug abuses of someone's great auntie under the care of Dr. Ewan Cameron. When everyone from Earl Morris to the Church of Scientology has profiled MKUltra, I figure that that shark has been jumped. Though it is startling that McGill University's Department of Psychiatry webpage has a history of the department mentioning Ewan Cameron and the Allen Memorial Institute with a straight face, but never once alludes to medical experiments on behalf of the CIA. When the Douglas was first proposed in 1881, local farmers protested that an insane asylum would sour their milk and haunt the land with madness and mayhem.
No, that was gophers.
A more accurate argument was that the mental health facility might lower property values. Complaints about the Douglas had been reported for years. In the summer of 1966, the body of a 20-year-old man was found near the Mount Royal Lookout, which is a popular destination for Montreal tourists. And these decomposing remains were just a few yards from the chalet restaurant for sightseers. The man was from Verdun, and so possibly a patient at the Douglas. And reports had been circulating to police of patients missing from the hospital. Possibly in response to any bad publicity in the spring of 1968, the Douglas Memorial Hospital conducted an open house, extending a welcome to the public.
Douglas shows off hospital. Douglas Memorial Hospital, a home for the mentally ill, threw open its doors to the public yesterday to promote better understanding of its care for the patients. And what the public saw were recreation centers, shops, a bakery, and a lot of people receiving the best of care. In the shops, people work for 10 cents an hour, or for nothing. Money's not important, finding themselves is. The calm of the hospital allows them to be creative, and they don't have to fight their way home in rush hour traffic. The staff smiles, and the visitor has the impression that they smile as well when the press and potential fund contributors aren't there. Ms. Stewart is an occupational therapist. Her job is to help bring patients back to reality in the conventional sense, and she gives the impression she really cares about it. The photographer was looking for children, but none could be found. The last time we did this, the kids became overly emotional at seeing people from the outside while they were here, she said. It wasn't a condemnation of either the outside world or the kids. It was simply a case of being human. And that's what the hospital is all about.
Our sunny ways, our sunny, sunny ways. Despite the effort, chafing continued between the hospital and the Verdun community. In May 1969, heroin addict Stanley Best turned himself in for treatment at the Douglas Hospital, arguing, "It's very difficult to withdraw. I need to get away from the milieu for 6 months." Best was soon back on the streets and arrested for drug peddling. The judge called him worse than a murderer. In April 1972, 20-year-old Ronald Rich escaped from the Douglas and murdered his 55-year-old mother. The coroner's inquest took 10 minutes to find Rich criminally insane. Ronald Rich admitted to the axe slaying, but said he didn't know why he killed his mother. In 1973, residents of Verdun demanded that the then 1,200 patients be given less freedom to walk the hospital grounds, complaining of imagined or real prowlers and break-ins. Argued city councillor Roger Seguin, "Our constituents are on both sides of that wall. They're inside that hospital as well as outside. We have to consider both." An early suspect in the 1974 murder of 12-year-old Norma O'Brien
was not the man eventually sentenced to a mental institution for her murder, Chateauguay killer Daniel Couliard, but a patient who went missing from the Douglas. No name was ever released, but the suspect was about 25 years old and weighed approximately 250 pounds. The inmate admitted to having been in the area where O'Brien's body was found in some bushes near Francois Boulevard in July 1974. O'Brien's left leg was broken during the assault. She had been gagged with her hairbrush and beaten with a rock. In the spring of 1975, a 27-year-old patient was found floating in the aqueduct of a Verdun waterworks plant. The young man had been missing since Christmas. In the summer of 1979, a 39-year-old patient went missing and was found hours later, drowned in the St. Lawrence River. In November 1985, an elderly man was found beaten to death with a rake on the grounds of the Douglas.
Lean out your window, golden hair. I heard you singing in the midnight air. My book.
We've talked a lot about the Douglas in past posts and podcasts, and one of the themes that developed was never fully explored was the number of suspects and victims of murder or sexual assault, particularly in the Teresa Martin affair, who had some affiliation with the Psychiatric Institute. Shirley Audette, for instance, murdered in 1969, was a former patient of the Douglas, and Wayne Bowden eventually confessed to her murder. Claudia Beauvais was a 21-year-old First Nations woman from the Kahnawake Reserve on the south shore of Montreal. The Montreal Gazette described her as having the mental state of a 4 or 5-year-old child. Since 1965, she had been interned at the Douglas Memorial Psychiatric Institute. She received treatment, but was not confined to her room or ward, free to roam the outside institution and to visit her parents on weekends. On the evening of July 3, 1969, Claudia went to see a movie screened on the Douglas campus. Later that evening, she did not return to her room. 5 days later, on July 8th, her mutilated body was found hidden in some bushes. The Quebec tabloid Allo Police wrote, "It was evident a veritable human monster was responsible, as the butchery was indescribable." Police did not suspect one of their over 2,000 patients on the Douglas campus. The grounds and the buildings were searched, but no blood or evidence was found within the residences. Suspicions began to be cast on a visitor or possibly an outpatient. Because she was Mohawk and from the Kahnawake Reserve, Claudia Beauvais' case generated, of course, little media attention. And we've talked about the Beauvais case before. However, since then, I was able to obtain a copy of Beauvais' coroner records, and the information is revealing. Children found the body of Claudia Beauvais. 3 kids between the ages of 8 and 10 living in Verdun climbed under the fence in their backyard onto the grounds of the Douglas. So a lot of these homes buttressed up against the fence of the Douglas. And they immediately ran home and told their mother they had found a dead body in the bushes. The mother, of course, said she didn't believe them, but as the kids kept insisting, a neighbor decided to check things out. He returned and he told the mother, "I think that something happened there." And she immediately called the Douglas Hospital. coroner Lauren LaPointe was insistent as to why she hadn't bothered to also inform the police. For this, Mrs. O'Reilly didn't have an answer. According to the statement given by her father, 63-year-old Jay Beauvais, Claudia had been living at the Douglas for about 4 or 5 years. As was her habit, she had spent the preceding weekend with her parents at their home on the lakefront in Kahnawake. Jay Beauvais went with his son to the medical examiners to identify the body. The next witness interviewed by the coroner was Henry Fanning, a Pinkerton security guard working at the Douglas. He received a call from the hospital switchboard that, quote, children had reported having seen a man lying down and being asleep. Fanning searched a wooded area on the grounds where two other children pointed to where the body was located. Under cross-questioning, the security guard admitted that he was not aware that Claudia Beauvais had been missing, despite a 5-day window from when she was last seen until her body was discovered. So, you know, you'd hope that the head of security at the hospital, let alone the Pinkertons, might be carrying this information as they were doing their security watch details on the campus. But perhaps I'm being too overly optimistic. Upon discovery of the body, Fanning immediately called the Verdun police. The last witness interviewed by Coroner LaPointe was Sergeant Detective Arthur Rousey of the Verdun police. Rousey received the call from Fanning and immediately proceeded to the hospital. After seeing the body, he notified the city morgue of the discovery. As of the date of his interview, which was September 26, 1969, almost 3 months after the murder, Sergeant Detective Rousey, one of the lead investigators on the case, had no further developments to report on the investigation. The coroner's determination ruled that Beauvais had been, quote, mutilated with an instrument that was sharp and penetrating, perhaps like a surgical instrument. Initially, a 34-year-old taxi driver from Toronto was held for questioning when he was seen lurking near the wooded area where Beauvais' body was found. By mid-July, police gave a statement. The condition of the victim's body leads us to believe we're dealing with a mentally deranged person who may strike again. It wasn't until 1973, over 4 years since Beauvais' murder, that attention turned to an offender named William Bill Market, also known as Bill Mason or Bill Reed, suspected of killing 3 women since 1969. Market had been a patient at the Douglas. He went to trial in 1973 for the stabbing death of Christine Harding. Harding had also been a patient at the Douglas. Market was originally from Verdun and was now also being considered for the murder of Beauvais. He was sent to trial for her murder as well, but the Crown ultimately withdrew the charge. The murders of Christine Harding and Claudia Beauvais remain unsolved. To Bill Market.
For a time, there was speculation that he might have been Bill Morton, the sometimes Sherbrooke Record reporter and Bishop's divinity student who went on to assault a patient at the Dixville, Quebec home for the handicapped in 1979. In 2015, now an ordained minister, this same Bill Morton was charged for an assault on a member of his parish in St. Stephen, New Brunswick. All of this is detailed in the podcast, The Tale of Mr. Morton, which I've linked on the website here. The suspicion that Bill Morton and Bill Market might be the same person proved false after a conversation with the New Brunswick RCMP. Bill Market had been wanted for questioning in 1973 by the RCMP for a murder in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia. So that's the third murder for which he was suspected. The St. Stephen detachment of the RCMP confirmed to me that Bill Morton and Bill Market were not the same person. As mentioned, Bill Market had also been an internment patient at the Douglas for about 10 years. So this places him at the hospital concurrently with Claudia Beauvais in 1969 and Christine Harding in 1973. As part of his legal process for the Harding murder, Market was admitted to the Pinel Institute at the time of his arrest for a 30-day psychiatric evaluation. Market was found fit to stand trial, but then the Crown decides not to proceed. So what happened? Well, it would appear that the Crown changed its mind, and that Market was immediately sentenced to a mental institution, either Pinel or the Douglas. A listener of this podcast website, named Joe, found Bill Market currently working for Nathan Kong, a fashion designer operating in the heart of Montreal. On their website, Market is described as a Montrealer who, quote, spent more than 40 years of his life in a mental institution only to get out at the age of 65. If this is true, Market, who was 22 in 1973, would have been released from some mental institution around, give or take, 2010. Nathan Kong is described as fashion accessories with a purpose, promoting that 100% of all proceeds are given back to the community to support and raise awareness for mental health. I don't understand how 100% of proceeds can go back. Math doesn't quite... A substantial portion of math doesn't work, but okay, we'll take their word for it. You know, all of this is very interesting. It's very fine. It's commendable from a mental health standpoint, but I have to ask, what about Claudia Beauvais and Christine Harding? And for that matter, the victim from Dartmouth, Nova Scotia? Maybe Market wasn't responsible for their deaths. If he wasn't, I think the public has a right to know the argument for excluding Bill Market as a suspect in these unsolved murders. For me, I'm glad Bill Market got treatment. But did Beauvais and Harding receive justice? In 1980,
Dr. Gilles Lefebvre, slipped quietly back into Canada and resumed his psychiatric responsibility, this time at the Douglas. The hospital was coping with a shortage of psychiatrists at the time. Disgraced and fired from the Pinel Institute in 1972 for his role in the Réal-Chartrand affair, it took authorities 7 years to realize their blunder. It wasn't until 1987, when Chartrand was appealing his life sentence, that the courts noticed that the man accused of gross negligence in the matter, which led to the Chartrand shooting of a Saint-Thérèse police constable, a man who plied Chartrand with psychotic drugs in an attempt to engage in a sexual relationship with his patient, was now in charge of the community psychiatric center in Verdun.
Feeling scared today. Write down, I am okay. 100 times, the doctor say. I am okay. I am okay.
The details that led to Lefebvre's dismissal from Pinel were described in a document known as the Clement Report, handed over to the Quebec Corporation of Physicians and Surgeons, but never made public. The Douglas Hospital wasn't aware of the report when it hired Lefebvre in 1980, though Lefebvre did inform a Douglas Board of Directors member, Gaston Harnois, at the time he was hired. He had been fired from Pinel and suspended by the Quebec Corporation of Physicians. Gaston Harnois' response was, "The past is the past. Who among us is perfect?" A patient's rights spokesperson commented, "We would be happier if he were in private practice where he wouldn't have so much power over patients."
Understood. Take me in your warm embrace.
This appears to be exactly what happened. When exactly Dr. Gilles Lefebvre left the Douglas Hospital in Verdun is unknown, but he was practicing psychiatry privately in the neighboring borough of LaSalle until his death in 2005. For over a decade, the Douglas appeared to have weathered the storm. In 1988, the Gazette ran a series on the crisis in mental health, a full feature on the Douglas with Arnois sermonizing, "There's a wall between the mentally ill and the community. If people open their minds and their hearts to these people, these programs will work." Then in 1999, Health Minister Pauline Marois ordered an assessment of alleged mismanagement and improper care of patients at the Douglas Hospital. The chief accusation was that the Douglas had begun to change its mission, emphasizing research over patient care. And from that we get the slow name progression to the Douglas Hospital Research Center, from anything associated with insanity or the mentally ill. The reports got even more specific when it was revealed that patients' teeth were literally rotting from their mouths. Hospital administrators fought back, blaming poor patient care on the provincial government's slashing of budgets, which forced the hospital to seek more private donations, which then tend to come with strings tied to research mandates. Complaints continued of less vulnerable patients being locked in wards with other violent and aggressive patients, mice and cockroach infestation, and that the government had cut budgets by $10 million over 5 years. The best way for the government to intervene is to re-inject money into the hospital because the situation is very grave. It's Henri-François Gautrin. Within a week, Quebec government health inspectors deemed conditions at the hospital as acceptable and called protests from reporters misleading, erroneous, and unfounded. According to the information available to us, it seems the Douglas Hospital has the situation in hand and that the quality of services and the premises are not under question. So the provincial government in Quebec does a turnaround when they figure out that they're the ones that are going to have to do something about the problem. Of course, a follow-up article in May 1999, Aaron Durfell profiled a patient who for years was plagued by unexplained injuries, such as bruises and cuts to the face. Said the patient's daughter, "We were appalled at the care my mother was given." Reliving the horror of her mother's swollen face. By the time of her death, 56-year-old Betty Burke weighed less than 98 pounds. The ghost with the one black eye indeed. In 2019, the Douglas Hospital was again under scrutiny. That spring, a 41-year-old male patient attacked an orderly. Then a month later, the same patient assaulted a nurse by repeatedly banging their head against the ward floor. Questions arose whether the hospital took the necessary precautions after the first assault. The patient was arrested for the second aggravated assault, but a union official said the inmate was well known for aggressive behavior. "We need to sit down with the employer to improve the situation for the staff and the patients." Asked what precautions the hospital intended to take, officials replied that they could not disclose information related to patients. That pitter-patter. Then in September 2018, another employee had been stabbed by a patient. Staff complained that the Douglas did not have enough employees to meet the needs of patients. And I think that this raises an important distinction between Pinel and the Douglas. In Pinel's case, it was a hospital for reforming criminals, hence the early name Pinel Institute for the criminally insane. The Douglas was mandate was never such a thing, and hence, and so you had patients who were criminals with mental obstacles mixed in with just normal everyday mental health patients, which was a toxic mess destined to implode.
On a distant shore, miles from land, stands the ebony totem in ebony sand, a dream in a mist of grey. On a far distant shore.
This has not been about Project MK Ultra. Nevertheless, you can't help but wonder about some things. Did research at the Allen Memorial Institute influence work being done at other medical facilities like the Douglas or Pinel or the Louis H? Both Claudia Beauvais and Bill Market would have been interned at the Douglas in the mid-60s. So that's about the right timeline. Is it possible they were subjected to some of the same drug treatments administered at the Allen at the same time? Was the drug administered to Réal Chartrand by Dr. Gilles Lefebvre, Doridan, also used by Dr. Ewan Cameron? The most commonly used term to describe the sort of mind control undertaken in the MKUltra experiments is brainwashing. In the Clement report, Lefebvre's treatment was described as such. If one had wanted to brainwash Réal Chartrand and bring him to the point where only acute psychosis or uncontrollable violence were possible, then one could hardly imagine a more efficient process than the one employed by Dr. Gilles
Le Fèvre. Still, these are matters that took place in some cases over 50 years ago. We may never know the influence sustained from Dr. Cameron and the Allen. Still, it's hard not to conceive of some cross-pollination occurring between medical facilities. Both the Douglas and the Allen operated under the umbrella of their parent organization, McGill University. So they're like the Bobbsey twins of medicine. It's hard to tell them apart. This is who killed Teresa. If you like the podcast, you can follow us on social media, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. There's links to all of those accounts on the website, teresalore.com, teresalore.com. We're on Substack, so you can get a written transcript of this episode by subscribing to Substack. If you go to the website, just to the right, there's a small menu. And under newsletter, you can subscribe to the Substack account there. I'm trying to do more work through that platform as we go forward. I would really appreciate a subscription or a share. Thank you very much. As we've gone along, I hope you've enjoyed the sequencing of some of the themes we've visited along the way. They've thematically kind of been, you know, about stories about place a little bit, meaning so we bounced into Ontario and then briefly into New York City, and here we are back in Montreal. We'll return to Saint-Thérèse next time, and then we'll close the year out back in the Eastern Townships. This has been Who Killed Teresa. I'm your host, John Allure. Stick around after the song, there's an Easter egg, and have yourselves a great, great day.
To find you.
Patricia Spencer and Pamela Hobley were last seen walking together near Escoda High School on Friday, October 31st, 1969. Hobley told her mother she'd be home after a high school football game and Halloween party. They have not been seen since. Michigan authorities believe the two teenagers were murdered.